Hey, welcome everybody to the Wraps Industry Panel at Sundance. I will just tell you that I was terrified that no one was going to find this room and that we wouldn't have anybody in this damn thing, even though my very good friends, new friends, old friends, I figured, well, we'll just have a smart conversation among ourselves and we'll record it and throw it up on the web. But I'm really glad you guys found us, so thanks for coming. We've been doing this panel for, I don't know, the Wraps 7 years old, so probably been doing it for 6 years. And it's been really interesting every year to watch how the industry changes. I just realized I probably should introduce myself to some of you who don't know me. I'm Sharon Waxman. I am the founder and the CEO and the editor-in-chief of The Wrap. As I said, we're 7 years old, but actually, just for the record, we're 7 years old tomorrow, which is really exciting. Just to tell you a tiny bit about how the Wrap has grown in that time, we started in my guest house with about five people, you know, breaking news. Like, how are people going to start reading the Wrap? My investors asked. I just said we're going to break news. We are now somewhere between 7 and 8 million unique readers per month on the web. We do 12. Woo! Thank you. We do about 12 beautiful print magazines a year. There's copies of them out on the countertop. You're welcome to take them along with your complimentary Wrap earmuffs that's on your chair. We're about 50 people at the company now, with about 25 of those people, reporters and editors, writing original news, text, video, photography. We have a gorgeous photography studio going on here for 3 days. We had a three-day video studio going on here for 3 days. So, but it started with this panel. That's the first thing we did because I knew that people would show up to have a smart conversation. So I just invite you all to be part of the Wrap community, to sign up for our daily newsletters, our breaking news if you're really an obsessive compulsive, which most of the people in the industry are. That's why you're in this industry. You're gluttons for punishment. And just want to thank all you guys for being here. So the other thing I needed to do was the dean of UCLA's School of Theater, Film, and Television, Terry Schwartz, is a sponsor of this panel for 5 years running, and she's always here to introduce our panelists and to talk about education and what they're doing at UCLA. She couldn't make it. I think she had to be at a screening today, but I want to specifically really thank Terry and UCLA for the work that they do, for being a partner to the Wrap, and for raising the next generation of filmmakers, which is a really important task, you know, that they do incredibly well. So thank you to UCLA. Okay. So let me go down, and this is usually the part that Terry comes in and says, "Hi, I'm Terry, and this is the panel." All right, so I'm Terry. Okay, our first panelist is Jay Cohn. Jay Cohn has over, I'm just gonna read these bios. Hold your applause till the end. I mean, some people like, I know Jay, he's seated in the audience, so don't. Okay, Jay has over 25 years of combined business, film, and TV experience. He is a partner and the head of film finance and distribution at the Gersh Agency, one of Hollywood's oldest and largest talent agencies, with 75 agents and offices in LA and New York. At Gersh, he oversees a department which represents multiple equity funds. He sells finished films and consults on independent financing for a wide spectrum of independent projects. Can I just call you Jay? It says Mr. Cohn.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, thanks. Jay's first film, which he produced and self-financed, was Swimming with Sharks, a film that remains as relevant today as when it was released in 1995. No kidding. His entertainment career includes a three-year partnership with Dustin Hoffman and Village Roadshow Pictures Australia, which led to A Walk on the Moon, The Devil's Arithmetic, Boys and Girls, Clubland, and A Separate Piece. He also created the company Cosmic Entertainment in partnership with Goldie Hawn, Kurt Russell, and Kate Hudson, which produced the Matthew Shepard story, Billy Meets Bobby, Orphan King, and Dark Blue, and starring Kurt Russell. Jay raised the capital for this venture, was responsible for the full-time staff, etc. So, Jay, thanks for being here.
Long bio.
Long bio. Long bio. I told him he only had an hour, but he didn't care. Liz Destro, our next panelist, is a producer who has no fewer than three films at this year's Sundance Film Festival. Congratulations, Liz. Liz began her career with numerous acclaimed and award-winning low-budget indies, including The Living Wake, Weapons, Explicit Ills, and The End of Love. Liz was an executive producer on Lee Daniels' The Butler, and she also produced Life of Crime starring Jennifer Aniston and Life After Birth starring Aubrey Plaza, Dane DeHaan, John C. Reilly, Molly Shannon, Cheryl Hines, and Paul Reiser. She is the producer of these three films at Sundance 2016, Kevin Smith's Yoga Hosers, starring Lily Rose Depp, Harley Quinn Smith, and Johnny Depp. I mean, Lily Rose was here yesterday. I just didn't know Johnny was in it. Okay. Jeff Bain is Joshy, starring Thomas Middleditch, Adam Pally, Nick Kroll, Alex Ross Perry, and Jenny Slate. And the short film, Too Legit, written and directed by Frankie Shaw, starring Zoe Kravitz and Teresa Palmer. Welcome, Liz. And we are thrilled to know that you have a film with Frankie Shaw, who was one of our shortlist finalists last year. And you were at our event. We have a shorts festival. If anybody wins an award, that's a short and wins an award. You should submit it for our shortlist festival, which is on in August. Frankie was one of our finalists last year, and there's good prizes, like there's money, because we think short filmmakers don't make enough money. That's what we think. Okay. Next is Daniel Hammond. Who was one of our sponsors of the Shortlist Festival this year. Thanks, Daniel. He is the co-founder and chief creative officer of Broadgreen Pictures. He co-founded Broadgreen with his brother Gabriel in 2014, so one of the welcome new distributors to the marketplace of independent film. Previously, Daniel spent much of the last decade in leadership positions at two financial services companies he co-founded with his brother, Steelpath Funds and Allerian, the premier financial index provider in the energy infrastructure space, which the brothers continue to co-own today. Penny Lane is the director of a feature documentary here at the Sundance Film Festival called Nuts. Penny was named one of Filmmaker Magazine's 25 New Faces of Independent Film in 2012. Her debut feature documentary, Our Nixon, premiered at Rotterdam and won the Ken Burns Award for Best of the Festival at Ann Arbor and was selected as the closing night film at New Directors New Films. Her other films have screened at AAFI Fest, Antimatter, Impact, too many festivals to mention, Penny, but lots of others, MoMA's documentary Fortnite. Her second feature-length documentary has world premieres here at Sundance, and then we'll have its international premiere in Rotterdam. You're going straight to Rotterdam from here, right? Crazy. And she's won grants from many, many, many excellent places. She was named Most Badass at the Iowa City Documentary Film Festival in 2009. She received her MFA in Integrated Electronic Arts at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute and her BA in American Culture and Media Studies at Vassar. She's taught film, video, and new media at Bard College and Williams College and is currently a professor in the Department of Art and Art History at Colgate, where she lives in a very old house. And yes, Penny Lane is her real name. Sam Tolles is the head of Global Content Acquisitions and Distributions at Vimeo. He leads the content, audience development, and operations team for Vimeo's on-demand business. In 2014, he joined Vimeo, which is now the largest open-access VOD platform worldwide with over 27,000 titles for more than 8,000 sellers. Programming highlights under Sam's leadership include the launch of Vimeo's first program, original program, High Maintenance, and exclusive new series including Oscar's Hotel and Con Man. A 19-year veteran of the entertainment industry, Sam's career began in theatrical marketing at New Line Cinema and Warner Brothers, followed by home entertainment roles at Paramount and Rhino. He then joined Fremantle Media as a VP of Business Development, overseeing media licenses for brands including American Idol, America's Got Talent, and The Price is Right. So thank you all for being here. It is a little bit of a mouthful to go through everybody's background, but I really think it's helpful because, you know, everybody who's here has been working at it for a really long time, except for Daniel, perhaps, what I mean is you never know until you actually start reading down a people's resume some of the stuff they've done, and you don't know who you guys might want to give your business card to when the conversation's over, but let's start with the topic that we wrote about this morning in the lead story on the Wrap Day, which had to do with how the streaming companies are really dominating this year's Sundance. And we've got, you know, Netflix came in and they plunked down $5 million and $7 million, respectively, before the festival even started. And then Amazon swooped in this weekend and put down $10 million for Kenny Lonergan's new film called Manchester by the Sea. It's a lot of money. A lot of the sort of more traditional distributors are either scratching their heads or a little nervous about how that might change the economic landscape. Let me start with Daniel, because you're here buying films. And so I guess, Sam, are you as well? You're the head of acquisition. I mean, I should clarify that.
Yes, we are buying films.
You're buying films. Okay, so I'd love to put that to the both of you guys. How do you feel about how that is, I'll say, messing with the ecosystem? of independent film.
I mean, it's
you need to talk.
Oh, do I? No,
yeah, sorry.
I'm doing this all wrong.
I'm the only one who does that.
I do this really fake microphone voice, though, which is the only problem, so I didn't really do it. But it's really kind of a fascinating landscape. Even Amazon, like last year for Brooklyn, they bid $5 million. This year for Manchester, it was 10. They're really sort of doubling down in the space and trying to figure out where they fit and how they're going to fit in terms of running campaigns for these movies that, you know, really want and sort of deserve, you know, a run at some sort of award campaign. Ted's a phenomenal guy. We've sat down with him. And
Ted Hope.
Ted mm-hmm. Hope is a fantastic mm-hmm. producer, and I really admire the work he's trying to do and trying to step up where a lot of studios are not daring to tread and paying the MGs. So movies that otherwise could not be made at certain budgets can be made because there's someone out there who's actually willing to put that bill to make it all work out. That being said, obviously, Broad Green, we believe in the theatrical release for films. And that's what we're doubling down for. And that's why we're building our business, is to be able to take films to the audiences they deserve in the space that we grew up watching them and wanting to watch them in. Obviously, last year at Sundance, we acquired both Walk in the Woods, Robert Redford and Nick Nolte, that we took out on like 2,200 screens. But we also acquired Sarah Silverman's, oh my goodness, I'm totally...
Yeah,
I smile back. Thank you.
Yeah,
which is a fantastic film, which was a day and date project, but that we took all the way to. I'll be there, you know, at SAG Awards with her, this coming Saturday for her well-deserved nomination for a fantastic and heartbreaking performance.
But you were not going to pay $10 million.
We were not going to pay $10 million for that. But we thought both were films that we could really champion and bring to audiences, and we've done just that.
So it's interesting, you know, you were saying that the rap is 7 years old, and in internet years, that's like 155, right? Things are moving. Vimeo's 10, so you're like...
We're only a little bit younger, your little sister.
And YouTube is 10. Like, the thing is interesting is that the evolution and how things are changing is moving at an incredible speed. What you're seeing with Netflix, Amazon, Hulu, and the, you know, burgeoning number of new services that are coming onto the marketplace is a deconstruction and reconstitution of cable television and of television in general. I mean, Netflix and Hulu and Amazon, to some extent, are like the ABC, NBC, and CBS of yesteryear. And new services like Vimeo hope to be the Fox, with a little bit of a different voice and a little bit of an edge. We want to trailblaze as well. We don't have the same budgets that Netflix and Amazon do. And we do something very different. You know, our model is a transactional model. And the thing I'm most proud of is that we give filmmakers 90% of the revenue that they generate on our platform. More importantly than the revenue, we give them the data. You know, the one thing that Netflix doesn't do is you give them your film, they give you a check, and that's the end of it. Like, you don't ever see where the traffic is coming from, who is your audience. So for a filmmaker, why is that important? Because they want to make their next film. They want to understand who is watching, why they're watching, how they're engaging. Why is it important for a distributor? They want to know the same thing. What should we invest in? How should we, you know, use our money to generate more return on investment? And, you know, Vimeo as a platform started with the notion that we would create the highest quality experience for creators to showcase their work. The evolution of Vimeo is to allow creators to showcase their work and monetize it on the highest quality platform possible on a global basis. And we are very, very proud to invest in original programming, but also to look to filmmakers at markets like Sundance and around the world to acquire their films and to market them and to bring them to new audiences. So,
well, I mean, I think that's amazing, but then you still have to play in a space where Amazon will write a check without blinking, in a bidding war where the next lowest bid is $7 million. So, Jay, like, is this are we in a bubble? Is this a new bubble that we're in? Because we've all seen bubbles at Sundance, in independent film, but it usually manifests itself most at Sundance.
I wouldn't call it a bubble. I think what you are in is a growth phase right now. Right? Netflix is a growth stock. Amazon is a growth stock. They don't think about a P&L for a movie, because what do they care? They could lose 100% of the money on
that
investment, because they're just trying to get subscribers. So if they have 10 million subscribers because they've bought a movie that added to a demographic that they weren't covering before in whatever country it's in, that's their objective, right? So They don't care if they lose money on the movie, whereas Daniel should care if he loses money on the movie because he won't be able to buy more
movies.
You
do care, yeah.
Right?
You do
care. I mean, these are large public traded stocks, right? So it's if you think about the studios, back when they were fun and creative, they were all private entities. They're all publicly traded stocks. Now the studios are in a very different business. If you look at where Netflix and Amazon goes, I mean, okay, so Netflix is financing all these bigger movies. If they have a couple movies, that, as he said, no one will ever know if the movies are profitable or not.
Right.
However, once subscribers' growth slows down and then they have to start dealing with the economics of it, the numbers will change. They have to change.
Liz, how is that for you? You're a producer. You're here selling movies, right?
Yeah, I'm definitely here. And I mean, we've had a huge discussion before coming here with our investors and the director, especially for Joshy, the one that premiered last night, because mm-hmm. that's the one that doesn't now have distribution, so mm-hmm. we're really hoping to sell it here. And you know, it's not as big, like the knowing our numbers and stuff like that. Like, it's really about the money and also about what kind of platform it's going to be released on. So if it was a huge theatrical and it was something that we could really bank on, I think as a filmmaker, doing the smaller, like 50-city, 100-city release has not been as successful as we had hoped it would be. So the difference between doing like a huge or like not like huge, like, you know, multi-thousand-dollar, thousand-theater type situation mm-hmm. is very attractive, but also a big check from Amazon or Netflix would also be extremely attractive, especially for a movie that we, you know, made on a fluke in Ojai and, you know, rented three houses and made it, you know, like, so that.
But you don't have to sell it for $10 million if you did it that way, right?
No, we don't. No, yeah, that's the thing. So, you know, we're going to weigh all the options as they come in. We're getting offers, you know, today.
Well, so that's my question. Well, congratulations on getting offers. That means you're going to sell it. That's amazing. Feel free to break the news with us when you finally make it to it. We'll get you Jeff Snyder's email. I want to ask, like, with the producer and the director on this panel, I mean, do you have, I think Liz just said that you don't have a preference as to whether you
Have a preference. I just want to make sure it's the right, I would rather do an Amazon or Netflix deal where I know that, like, that's, everyone's making their money back and I feel like that's a success in itself than to try to do a theatrical with the wrong partner. That would be.
Penny, how do you feel?
Well, I mean, I think about this from the perspective of my own viewing habits. And, you know, not everybody lives in a big city where there's, like, cool art cinema playing.
Right.
I live in the countryside, and thank God for Vimeo, you know, and streaming video and all these things, because that's how I see amazing fucking cinema. So, you know, there's no movie theater there, literally. And if there is, it's just Star Wars all the time. That's most of the country, guys.
Yeah.
Like, so, so I don't know, because I make very low budget films. I have a teaching career. So, like, this stuff is not, like, it doesn't, like, sales
teaching
are not.
Teaching's where the real money is, you're right.
Yeah.
Good one.
I mean, I'm sorry, compared to independent documentary filmmaking, yes. So, yeah, so for me, you know, like, a sale, I mean, I'm going to sell my film and then I'm going to make money on it, which is great, but it's not actually how I pay my mortgage. So these kind of discussions for me, really, I think about them more in terms of reach and, you know, people out there actually getting to see my film.
Well, tell us about your film.
Yeah.
Nuts is a half archival, half animated documentary film about a guy who 100 years ago told the world that he had cured impotence with goat testicle transplantation. And the story of his life is the story of my film.
He give goat testicles to people?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow, so. Nuts.
You just got to come see it, guys.
Yeah.
Well, that's exciting.
But I think it's it's an interesting question, though, which is theatrical for independent film as relevant today?
Right.
Because what we're trying to do, a lot of filmmakers I meet with are like, the theatrical is the most important thing. And really, for many filmmakers, all you're doing by going with a distributor who funds your P&A is digging yourself a deep hole which you can never recoup from. You're just going deeper and deeper into debt on a film that you've already paid to make, because you're trying to run that project through 125-year-old technology. When a platform like Amazon or Netflix or someone say like Vimeo might bring you a lot more eyeballs and a lot more audience and be much more favorable to your bottom line, and to your point, getting that incredible, Penny is talking about, you know, cities even the size of my hometown of Buffalo don't have the kind of cinema penetration that New York or LA do. And so I think that the digital age is exciting, and filmmakers should embrace the idea of getting someone to see your film in a world where all films and all television and all of the entire weight of film history exists is probably something more important than putting it up on a silver screen.
But can I just say, so yeah. We're talking about something, you're talking about success of Amazon and Netflix and what's happening. 95%, and I have to preface this, my daughter's always telling me not to ruin people's dreams when I do this. 95% of independent movies lose money. 95%. So we're talking about the five that don't at this festival. The rest all will either not be sold or will not make their money back. So when we're talking about Amazon and Netflix or Broadgreen or what they're doing over Vimeo, I mean, that's the good thing. That's the win. But when you make independent movies, you really have to, and I say this to every single person we work with, who's your audience, who's the movie for, know what the numbers are, and make sure you have an understanding of what the true objective of the movie is. If it's to be seen, then don't worry about a theatrical because it's a waste of time. Because people don't go to movies anymore. The independent
space is challenging. So you're saying that because what the conversation is, but by the way, I have to say, this needle has moved. We have done this panel, as I say, for 5 years. There was a really serious argument on this panel 3 years ago. You weren't on it. It was Lynn Shelton who was shouting down somebody who was, you know, making Sam's argument. I might have been from YouTube. And it got a little acrimonious. She was like, theatrical is why I make movies. And, you know, Daniel went into this business, as he said.
I just, like, I mean, of course, yay. But, you know, realistically, what do you do? You know, and I'm perfectly happy to have my film be seen on Netflix. And I'm also willing to acknowledge that that's a very different experience, and it's not a bad experience. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. It's like, that's how I watch movies. Am I going to denigrate that? That's how I do it. Like, so it's hard for me to get all high and mighty about theatrical.
Our first film, which actually Jay packaged for us and put together, Breakpoint, was a day and date release. We realized that was the best way to get it the most eyeballs possible and really get it out there to the audience that we felt would see it, and we didn't think theatrical made sense.
So I just want to say one thing. It's really about prestige, what I see with my peer group. The theatrical is prestige. Absolutely. They know they're going to lose money. They know it's a stupid idea.
Well, like, hang on.
But they want a review in the New York Times. And I don't blame them. They can't get that otherwise, you know?
So first of all, the New York Times is not reviewing every theatrical movie anymore. That's a big change because they can't keep up. Mm-hmm. And I don't blame any filmmaker for wanting their film to be in a theater. But the question is, it used to be, like 6 months ago or a year ago, we would have the conversation that putting it out in theatrical was essentially a marketing tool to let more people know about it because you go onto Vimeo or whatever, like, what the hell do you watch? Like, how do you find the movie? Now I know to look for your movie, but, you know, it's just not efficient for you to have to meet every single viewer personally.
But it still goes back to the same thing. If you want a true theatrical movie, and that's Lynn Shelton, that's what she does. If that's what you want, you know what you're competing against, and you have to design a movie that will work in that space. If you don't think about that, it will never get there.
So what does that mean? Can you actually cost out? In other words, I'm going to make, here's a version of my budget if I'm going to make it, if I'm going to do a theatrical deal. Here's a version of my budget if I only can do it on, you know, another way.
That's one version, but also think about what the subject matter is and look at competitive movies to what you're making and say, okay, here are the top 10 movies that are similar to what I did. How did they do? Where did they play? Did they have success in Chicago? Did they have success in New York? Or did nobody go to see them? And put yourself, the business is so challenging, but I will say one thing. There's a lot of money in the marketplace, so it's not that hard to get movies made if they're good. It really is hard to get distribution, and thankfully these people are here and they're adding, but still, they only have so much money, right? Daniel's not Paramount. Vimeo's not Paramount, right?
Paramount's not releasing that many movies. They have a finite amount of money to spend. Paramount just cut their distribution down to like 10 or whatever.
It's hard selling movies because for a distributor to buy your movie, it's not about how much they pay. It's about how much it's going to cost to market it. Mm-hmm. And then really what it's about is the opportunity cost of marketing that movie instead of another movie.
That's right.
So there's risk to both sides of it. Right. And that's what you have to think about as filmmakers. What's the market? Where does my movie fit in, or doesn't it? And look, we did a movie with Dustin Hoffman and Adam Sandler last year. Tom McCarthy directed it. We suggested not to worry about the theatrical release. Mm-hmm. Adam Sandler was all in on digital. It made a lot of money.
Which film?
He wasn't so worried about, you know, the success of a theatrical release. It was called The Cobbler. And really cute little fun movie, but you know, we did it for price, and nobody worried about we need to be in 2,000 screens, because that would have been stupid.
Well, Liz, when you work with directors, I mean, tell us what is that conversation? Because, you know,
obviously all directors want their movies in theaters. I think it's like a natural instinct. And it, you know, as a filmmaker, you watch your movie on a big screen and you've mixed it for theatrical. You've done everything to see it on that big screen. So it is, you know, you want it there. It depends on what the film is and what's going on. But I think now, especially the younger directors are becoming much more realistic with that. I think even like Kevin, I'm not saying that he'd be open to it, but
Kevin
I think
Smith?
That he is like definitely his over the past couple of years, there's been education for the older directors who have been in the business and used to huge releases and like worldwide, you know, like huge.
I mean, Kevin seems to be like Kevin Smith, who, you know, going all the way back to Clerks or whatever, feels like the kind of guy who's so niche, who's so cult that he'd be perfect for streaming, actually, not for theatrical.
Yeah.
Because you're just going to, I would think.
Also, but for him, it's like a strange situation, too, because he has such a unique fan base.
Yeah.
And he, many people don't know this, but he travels the country and he does these speaking tours, and they sell out, like, huge.
I'm
like,
sure.
So if he went around the country with a theatrical package, like, I think that that could be a very successful, a unique way of going theatrical for a movie like Yoga Hosers. Because he literally sells out every show. He travels like 300 days a year.
I mean, somebody like Kevin could start a YouTube channel and just, you know,
he has
monetize
a YouTube channel. Yeah,
I understand that, but like actually monetize it. We had we do for those who don't know, we do a business conference called The Grill, which is all about convergence of entertainment and technology. And Lloyd Braun, who's now the head of Whale Rock, he introduced this whole sort of horizontal, basically a different business model of creating content for people who have brands. Kevin would be perfect. So he started out with Kim Kardashian and Howard Stern, and people pay subscriptions for $4.99 a month because they just can't get enough of everything Kim Kardashian does in addition to what she does on E! I would think that there is a way for Kevin Smith not only to put his own films on a channel like that where the money goes in his pocket, right? Not through, and Lloyd Braun's company takes a small percentage and not the other way around, like on YouTube, right? Because that's a problem, like with snack films or whatever, that, you know, I know that, you know, there's a really good attempt to try to monetize independent film, but the question I was always asking, do the filmmakers make a living at it?
Well, certainly Kevin does, but,
He's smart. Yeah,
he is smart, yeah.
He's smart, but he works it. He's going out and speaking, he works it on social media. It's a job.
Oh, yeah.
Right, but he could also curate movies. People would sign up $4 or $5 a month just to see what Kevin Smith thinks you should be watching, I would think.
Sure.
Right. to you guys, does that seem like just too much work? It's more work for you guys as the creators. If you have to create
I don't want to really be a distributor. I mean, it's not my goal.
You don't want
to. But I'm pretty into it. Like, I would say, like, I like social media. Like, I'm into, like, cultivating my own fan base. I do a lot of Kickstarters. It's a huge part of it. That's awesome. But I would rather spend more of my time currently making art and less of it begging for money and attention. So I certainly wouldn't want to do more.
Yeah, the 6 months that you're delivering the movie is the worst, like, part of the filmmaking process, I think. Mm-hmm. And then you just have to trust your distributor, I think.
But there are a couple of things here. First, I think that we live in a digital age. Digital marketing provides data. Data is critical for filmmakers, for distributors, for everybody.
It's a really good
data
point.
Is the most important asset that you can access. And Vimeo is going to continue to push others to give data because that is the way that you will learn and be able to build. The second point is this. The most successful titles on our platform have been where creators have engaged their audience from the very beginning of the production cycle and continue to take them through the journey. I use one of my favorite examples. I sat on a panel with a YouTube creator named PJ Liguori, who did Oscars Hotel with New Form Digital. And we were the exclusive release partner. We were a partial funder of that film, of that series. And he is a YouTuber. And one of the questions on the panel was asked, like, how do you do your YouTube channel and make a really cool piece of high-quality premium content? And he said, you know, what's interesting is when we were writing it, we'd get stuck and we'd ask our audience on YouTube, like, can you help solve this problem? And they would come back with great suggestions, and he would incorporate it into the scripts. And then when they were shooting, he'd go, oh my God, today's shooting, and we're just stuck on the scene, and we can't figure it out. And they would come back, and they would give him ideas as to how to make that scene better. And it was, it is still holds the record for our number one top-selling film of the top-selling project of the first day. And it's because his audience was passionate, engaged, and when that project came out and launched on Vimeo, they were hungry and ready to buy it.
So Sam, are we talking in the tens of thousands of dollars? Are we talking in the hundreds of thousands of dollars? What are we talking?
It is hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Hundreds of thousands of dollars. It's going to go to that filmmaker.
Yes.
Yeah.
But you need a filmmaker who doesn't know the movie he's making, so he needs the audience to help him.
No, it's fine. No, no.
Well, I mean, like, I've never.
I'm not making that movie.
I don't know what a YouTuber is. Is that a filmmaker?
Look, I think there are I think there are digital creators. I think there are digital creators. Some of them are on Vimeo, the better ones. Others are on YouTube. And look, I think both platforms are different and have different functionality for different people that are doing different kinds of content. And someone like PJ was making really high quality premium content, and we felt that just because he started on YouTube as a platform, we felt that the level of his content elevated to a point where it belonged and should be showcased on Vimeo. And the amount, and you know, you guys that are doing the big 10 million Amazon films might poo-poo at several hundred thousand
dollars. Who's doing that?
But it might may poo-poo at several hundred thousand dollars in revenue filmmaker, but for somebody who's monetizing on YouTube, how many streams is that? That's hundreds and hundreds of millions of streams to make that same amount of money. And so it's really meaningful to that kind of new generation of creator to have a source that they can monetize at a much better rate, at that 90% at that minus.
So let me ask you then, so how many streams to get into the hundreds of thousands on Vimeo, how many streams was that on that particular project that we're talking about?
Well, we are selling it, so it's transactions.
Okay, how many streams?
So for that project, was it 10 or 15? I can't remember, Courtney.
Like, you can't say that data's private.
That's true. I can't tell you how many total streams.
Well, but you can't throw stones at Netflix.
You're talking about tens of thousands of transactions to make hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Tens of thousands of transactions of people buying the film?
Correct.
Okay, that's doable. I can get my brain around that, and probably people here can get your brain around that.
But it's actually a really interesting point that he's talking about, which is audience engagement and using social media. And what I would say on the independent film basis, which is really important, is you don't have to use YouTube stars, but what's interesting on the indie film side is there are so many actors who are not famous, let's just say movie star actors, who have millions of followers on social media, right?
Or at least, like, or hundreds of thousands of
no,
millions.
No, but
millions?
Like, there are television actors who we all have seen on television who you don't think about in a movie, who don't get movie offers. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Jaron and I just put a movie together where we had, the budget was like $1.1 million, and our three leads who are not used to being leads on movies had 6 million followers. And we convinced the financier of how we're gonna use their following to market the movie to break their money faster, right? So part of the relevancy is use what's hot on social media. Take a rap star who's never acted.
Give
if
him a
he or she has a large following, give them a part in the movie. Mm-hmm. Now all of a sudden you can monetize the social media value to raise money to help you with distribution. And you're also then looking at their core audience and their demographic and saying, this is how we can use this to market, so that when you go to Sam or Daniel and you say, okay, this is where I am, it may be easier to market this film. Mm-hmm. That's where you should take that, right? Not, I mean, the YouTubers are one thing, and we do that all the time at our agency, but it really should be, okay, there's a girl on Pretty Little Liars who has 6 million followers. She's not getting movie offers. There's a guy on, Teen Wolf. He's got millions of followers. He was in your movie. Yeah. I know.
did you think about that when you were putting the movie together?
Kevin's daughter and Johnny Depp's daughter are the two leads, and they were huge fans of Tyler. And of course, we looked him up, and we're like, sure.
Tyler Posey.
And Austin Butler are the two boys, and they both have huge followings, and they're both in, like, you know, these types of situations, but they do have huge social media presence. Thank you.
So, but you're saying that you didn't think about that. That was really more because the
We definitely considered it when we were looking at him, and I made him the offer to be in the movie, but we weren't going to say no to Kevin for his choice of cast.
Yeah, of course.
But it just obviously helps considerably. Those two girls, like Lily Rose and Harley, have a crazy number of followers as
I can't
well.
Imagine Johnny Depp's on Twitter.
I don't think so. I haven't seen it.
I would guess not. He doesn't need more following. People following. Yeah. Yeah. That's how. Well, let me just go down and ask everybody how you're using social media in your various endeavors, whether it's in the business, in your business, or on the creative side. Daniel,
Well, it's funny because I'm sort of a huge Luddite, and I don't actually have any social media myself. But my team is fantastic. And but as everyone said, what really matters is the engagement from the stars. Like Sarah Silverman on I Smell Mac was fantastic about getting the word out there, about making videos for her followers, about being everywhere, doing everything to get the word out. And that sort of engagement from your team and your cast is so important in making sure, as you said, that it's people who, even if they're not the biggest stars in the world, have the following.
You put that it's like in your marketing plan?
Absolutely.
It's in your marketing.
100% integrated. Mm-hmm. Anyway, we have a digital strategy. We have digital media people who have been working on it. I mean, one of the beautiful things of what we're trying to put together is that we can do everything at once in a sort of holistic way. So as we're developing out a movie, we have already, like, we sit down with our digital people and we say, like, how can we really activate this and how can we really bring this to people? And more than having a digital plan that's not just, we'll have a great Facebook page.
Right.
Because that's so often the sort of the answer. Like, we'll have creative tweets. Like, that's not enough. I mean, you really have to do something with it. And that's what we're trying to do.
So, I mean, is there a particular campaign that you can point to that you feel like really worked that you did on sort of to engage the people who really would be interested in one of
It's interesting. I mean, I'm particularly proud of the work we did on 99 Homes, actually. We did fantastic. Al Venny, who's our digital head.
Okay, round of applause for 99 Homes, because it's a great movie.
She did just a spectacular job and won a number of sort of industry awards and nods, and she just did an amazing.
Val
Aveni, our head of digital, just did a fantastic job of getting what is a very complicated film and a very complicated message out there in a way that was digestible and impactful. And
what was the heart of the campaign, or what did she do?
She did a number of there were a couple of prongs to it. Basically, she created a number of sites and little packages, and where you could really just go in and sort of be a little bit of part of the world, and whether that was like getting behind like Michael Shannon and like getting to see like the universe of like being that
Michael Shannon or his character?
His character. And really sort of, or like going into the world of Dennis Nash and seeing a little bit of that, little snapshots of the universe that we were creating.
Mm-hmm. And what's interesting is if you have that social media talent in your movie, it actually makes it less expensive to market. It's not like buying big television ads, or you don't have to spend the same money because social media followers are rabid to the fans they like. And so mm-hmm. you can get 10%, 12% of those fans to instantly download. It's just that easy.
Well, that's also true.
It saves so much money.
Right. If they don't have to go to the theater, if you can actually...
But
you can convert them to...
Let's use a real-life example of why theatrical... and is kind of a weird approach. If you guys follow politics, Jeb Bush has spent $100 million on advertising and sits at 2% of the polls. Donald Trump's probably spent $100,000 in advertising and may win the Republican nomination. And that's all social media. That's all using data and really driving retargeting and all of the kind of things, again, that you can get when we market a film, we do the primary marketing. In fact, the vast majority of marketing that we've ever spent has been online because we can... If you have an engaged following on Facebook or Twitter or YouTube or Instagram or any of the platforms, we can then sort of follow and see what you're doing, what you like, what's happening, where you go, and we can show you content that's interesting and relevant to you. It's a much more efficient way of building awareness. Again, the challenge for filmmakers today is that unlike in previous times when there were a limited number of slots on a video short store shelf, you had to tune in to television, and if you missed it, there was no DVR, there was no iTunes and catalogs of millions of films and TV shows that you had instant access to at your fingertips at any hour of the day. Your films are competing with every film that's ever been made, from Star Wars right now to The Godfather to Wings in 1926, and every television show. So you've got to get to your audience. You must find a way to to let them know that your film exists. And the most efficient and effective way is to dive into social media, leverage it, and if you have a partner who's smart and who can market against it, that will increase your chances of getting your film seen and being successful.
That's great. Penny, were you going to say something about social media?
Not really. I was thinking about crowdfunding. I'm not, you know, it's
talk
sort of a different
that.
Subject,
yeah.
But
sure.
It's really, I mean, it's related in the sense
that is, so
you know,
it's a social. It's
yeah,
absolutely.
Absolutely.
Social
and function. I love it. I mean, to me, I think about when I launched those campaigns, I raised about half the budget of both of my features, crowdfunding, Kickstarter specifically.
What was your budget?
Oh, God, geez. I don't usually talk about this stuff, but I guess that's this room. Like, yeah, way less than a million. That's let's all. Put it that way.
Less than 100,000?
Yeah, around there, let's
okay.
say. Yeah.
Okay.
So for me, you know, having a couple hundred super fans really makes a big difference in my life. And, you know, when Nuts came to Sundance, you better believe that those, like, 800 Kickstarter backers were really excited. And they're all posting it all the time on Twitter and Facebook because they've been in on this from the beginning. It's exactly what you were saying before. So it's not an original point, but that's kind of what I was thinking about.
And how did you feel about using crowdfunding? I mean, you just said you'd rather spend your time making your art and not on distribution.
Yeah, except
but
this
in fact,
is fun because, you know, like writing a grant is okay. Begging rich people for money, I don't like. You just got to choose your poison. Like, raising money is really hard, right? Like, there's no easy way to do it. I find crowdfunding to be enjoyable. So I choose to do that. You know, someone else would rather have a bunch of lunches with skeezy rich guys until you get a check.
I object to all of this.
I'm not like...
Why do I feel that was about me?
I don't. So no. I mean, but so you know, different people enjoy different things. So I like crowdfunding. It's really fun. I think of it as a market test. If what I'm putting out isn't picking up, like people aren't picking it up, then I got to think about how I'm describing my film. I got to change
okay,
it. You know.
So I do need to ask, in your documentary about goat testicles, what were you giving away on your crowdfunding offer?
Well, my movie's animated, so one of the really popular things was that people could pledge to have their cameo, like an animated cameo in the film, so that really worked really well. People loved that. Stills from the animation, you know, and it's mostly just that people want to copy the movie. That's, you know, the 90%.
I was worried they were maybe delicacies.
No.
Okay. I'm going to go ahead and speak.
I was going to say, one of the cool digital sort of solutions that we're trying to, you know, explore and look into is this company called Tug that we have a strategic partnership with that does crowdsourced theatrical events. So you can, if you have that Kickstarter audience, if you have those built-in fans, you can, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Is Tug here?
Is Tug here?
Maybe.
Oh.
Well,
yeah.
You have the ability to get that, you, no matter where you are in the country, you have the ability to get that DCP to that theater and see it in a theatrical experience with all the fans who really love that and really want to become a part of that experience. And I think it's fantastic, the work they're doing.
That's cool. I'd like to see ways that we can help encourage people to know about that because
exactly.
I think it's too thin a layer right now who's aware of it.
Yeah, we're trying to.
But can, by the way, I don't know the answer.
I would do that like, you know, on an old movie, you know, would be really
exactly.
fun to do.
Exactly. Do that too.
You know?
Can you raise P&A money on Kickstarter? Like, I don't even know, crowdfunding? Can
yes.
you raise
Can you educate,
money?
Please, Jay, about, you know.
I don't know what P&A means.
Yes, the answer is yes. You can.
No,
you
come on, explain. It's print and advertising. It's essentially the marketing budget for your film.
So if you make you can raise movie, take it on theaters,
you can
raise
do
money.
Finishing funds, P&A,
any of that.
One point about crowdfunding, though, which I would like to tell, because you said most people want to get the film. I have to push back against that, because as a platform that sells direct, one of the things that we have seen is that the people who have made a lot more money in crowdfunding, we are strategically aligned with both the crowdfunding platforms and get a lot of projects that come from that. The crowdfunded projects that do most success on Vimeo are the ones where the film has not been given away. Because then you're encouraging people to support your art, to say, hey, I want that animated GIF. I want to have my name in the credit. I want to see this get made. It's not necessarily a pre-sale of the film. And so if you have 1,000 or 5,000 or 10,000 people who have crowdfunded your film, those are all your best customers. You really want to make sure that the film is treated as a premium. It's not to say don't give it away, but don't give it away for free, guys. This is your life. This is what you're doing as your passion. Your film is worth more, and you can sell it to people when it's ready to be made, and those people will buy it because they've supported it. So just keep that in mind when you're doing crowdfunding.
So basically you're saying sell something else, not the film itself.
Or if you do sell a film, don't sell it for like $20. You know, exactly. You can bring it up a bit, like so that it is kind of more premium. You say a signed DVD, for example, for $100
right.
as opposed to, you know, all of your best customers not being around to buy your movie
That's
when it's
exactly
done.
Right. Yeah.
Penny, how much time, I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt you, but how much, out of curiosity, how much time did you devote to the Kickstarter piece?
I would say each one was about 6 weeks long and, you know, probably 6 weeks of prep, halftime, and then it's really full-time during the length of the campaign.
It is, right? That's
oh, absolutely. Right. Yeah, full-time.
Yeah.
If you're doing it right, it should be full-time.
Okay, yeah. Sorry.
I was just going to say, we've had very mixed results with crowdfunding to finance a movie. On the negative side, we had an actress who, and you have to really be careful, and as you were saying, you have to really understand your actors, because some actors get a lot of negative publicity off of crowdfunding because they're perceived to be so rich. And so we did a movie a few years ago where the star of the movie went on a crowdfunding source with us and got so much backlash.
You're
she
not,
fired
you're,
her agency.
She fired her agency?
Thought, she thought they should have protected her. But they had no way of knowing what was going to happen. Wow. But then on the other side, I will say that if you're very specific topic, like a very specific type of film, for instance, we did an LGBT movie not long ago. We had a great crowdfunding group because it was...
With a known actor.
With a known actor. And it was a very specific audience. And so we knew how to go after that and bring them in the right way. And so if you're making a movie that has a very specific brand or core audience, it's very easy to raise money on a crowdfunding site, and it's a great way to do it.
Yeah, there was an initial big backlash when I'm trying. It's the name is escaping me.
Zach Braff.
Zach Braff.
I was like Zach Efron. Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
Stallone did one.
Stallone did one.
Stallone did one. Didn't go so well.
People weren't so psyched about Spike Lee's either. So
Yeah. I'm going to open it up because I'm sure there's a lot of questions, and we don't have we have limited time. So, do you guys have any questions for this really brainy group? Yeah. Do you want to stand up and so everybody can hear you?
This is for Vimeo. I want to hear about your women's initiative.
Oh,
tell us about your women's initiative.
I want to give a shout out to two women at Vimeo who are very influential. Courtney and Jessica, basically, among other women at Vimeo, are the reason that this initiative exists.
Here? Raise your hands.
They are awesome.
Thank you.
Look, you know, I read a statistic recently that said that the number of female directors, and it was with 2014 or 2015, from a percentage basis of films made, was the same as it was in 1946. And that is just wrong. There are so many talented female filmmakers, producers, creators, executive producers, writers, thank you. And you know, we as leaders in Hollywood, Vimeo being a major company that has an obligation to start pushing the envelope and bringing gender equality to an industry that has not traditionally had gender equality. And so, you know, the Female Filmmaking Initiative is a lens that we put on both our development and production funding process, as well as on our acquisitions process, to say we want to make sure that in 2016 and going forward, that we have more equality, more women that are getting funding, that are getting distribution, that are getting the programs that we offer, and really make that a focus and put that in the minds of everybody who's on my team, who's acquiring and producing content, so that when we look at projects, we say, if this is good and it's from a woman, we should give it extra consideration to close that gap. And we're very, very proud to announce that here at Sundance in partnership with Sundance. And I'm very proud to work for a company that takes gender equality as seriously as we do and are putting our money where our mouth is.
Fantastic.
Are you finding the data that women are out there looking at things? And are you finding the data in your
Women are as avid a consumer of entertainment as men, and are more than half of the population. And the bottom line is that for whatever reason, and we don't need to lament the past. I'm about thinking about the future, but it's not necessarily about there being less women than men consuming. It's about the women that are creating are not getting the same shot at getting their work seen, and we want to make sure that we do what we can to, again, close that gap.
It's the second film phenomenon, right? So, I mean, my first film, it was very successful. I was in a kind of community of peers that were kind of also making their first film, and watching the way that the men filmmakers were trusted with the second film, just trusted, whether or not the second film had anything to do with their first film, whether or not it was like 10 times as big of a budget. People were like, oh yeah, he can do it. And it was like pulling teeth for the women in my community to get a second film funded. It's shocking, and it really surprised me, really.
It's funny because we had a bit of a kerfuffle in our interview studio here.
We need to have a kerfuffle. Are we going to have one?
Good. Yeah,
you have very limited time left.
Well, actually, it's either not enough time. Somebody better throw a punch. But no, it's Julie Delpy. Julie Delpy was. We were talking about diversity at the Oscars, which of course is a big issue. And you know, Julie just sort of came from her gut. She was just like, you know, I brought this issue up 2 years ago, and I just got ripped to shreds in the media for it. And afterwards. That she made some comment like, you know, sometimes I wish I were African American, which people took the wrong way. I don't think she meant it like that, but she's taken a lot of heat for it. But afterwards, she sort of said, look, I just have so much trouble getting my films made. And I just felt, you know, it's the same thing. Like, that Julie Delpy doesn't really have to prove herself. She's been Oscar nominated twice in the writing category, not the acting category. So I think that your experience of the second film thing is probably echoed, you know,
by a lot
of your
peers. How many of these amazing women go on to even make a second film. I mean, you know, some of the most amazing filmmakers that I can think of in the last 20 years just never even made a second film, which is a little heartbreaking.
That'd be interesting to ask them why. Did you want to say something about this? You don't have to.
I think it's a problem. It's a huge problem. Yeah. I made the short with Frankie Shaw, who won last year, and, I mean, her films are extremely...
funny.
Provocative, yeah. But I really want to see her make a feature, but I think it's...
Well, she's doing something for Showtime, isn't she?
She's a series in development of Showtime, but I think it's just inherently harder for female filmmakers to get their work made. I'm always with guys. Like, 99% of my movies are partnered with tons of men, but it's fine.
So because that's where you can work. That's where you find you're able to move your stuff forward.
Yeah, it just happens that way. But like Kevin and Jeff Bain actually work very well with women, and a lot of their crew is, like, almost all of Kevin's crew is almost always female. So,
okay, let's take some more questions. Yeah, over here.
I have a question for the two distributors on the panel, mostly Sam, I think. It feels like there's more and more content all the time as technology is getting more accessible. But the number of what Jay would call bankable stars is not going up at the same rate. So those of us who are trying to make films are all sort of fighting for the same small group of talent to be in them. So it sounds like there are other resources and to mine, like YouTube. How do you kind of rank these bankable, these theatrical names versus someone with a TV show versus somebody who has a million followers on YouTube? As we're casting our films, how do we know what's going to be appealing to you? And so I can tell Jay that I have this person that Sam likes.
I'm back to being sleazy.
Look, my father's a film professor, and you know, he very, very much a part of the filmmaking world. And the thing I've told him, and I wish I could tell every film professor, is the world is changing, and we need to teach filmmakers how to be marketers in their mind as well as creators. That is not to say that you shouldn't make something that you're passionate about. In fact, it's exactly the opposite. Again, what we see on our platform is that the creators who are have the most passion and the people that are in their films that have the most passion are the projects that are most successful. What I mean by that is you can hire a YouTuber or a digital star or a rapper. If they're taking a check and that's why they're doing the movie, good luck. Because the first question I get asked occasionally when I'm dealing with influencers is, how many tweets do I have to do contractually? Done. Not going to do that deal. Never, 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 never. You have to find, and Jay said something interesting also. There are tons of niche audiences that are ridiculously underserved. LGBT is one. We've had enormous success in the LGBT space because they're underrepresented audiences. So I think it's about finding a project that you're passionate about, then attaching it to the audience, seeing which audience is it that you're going to address, and then finding influencers, people that have relevance and meaning to that audience, that are passionate about telling your story, and then communicating with those people throughout the process so that you're building excitement and basically advocates for your project, so that when you ultimately on that launch date, the film comes out, whether it's theatrical or on Vimeo or on Netflix or on Amazon or wherever, that there's a group of people that the influencer also, the people in your film, the people that they've talked to, the people that you've talked to, are all saying, cut through the clutter, this is the project that I have to see.
Great answer. Question here?
Sorry, also for Sam.
I feel embarrassed. I want to call.
Sam's going to have a breakout session after this.
Not coming from the filmmaker side, coming from the marketing side, transitional VOD platforms and such. Netflix, first to market, took over early on with the consumer facing. Amazon is the world of consumer facing. Vimeo has done the most amazing job of being the B2B. Filmmakers know anytime you're sending a link, it's a Vimeo link with a password and you're done. Mm-hmm. What is the plan for Vimeo to be competitive in the consumer-facing marketplace such that your filmmakers who are now, not that you've acquired, let's say, but who are doing the on-demand or, such that they can trust that you have the forward-facing consumer?
I just did a session with our executive team. Private session, you guys weren't invited. and that was the exact question that was at the center and forefront is what is the map of our evolution?
Yeah.
And all of the, all of the people at Vimeo are very focused on this because what you're asking is critically important for us to be successful. Part of it is through our transactional service. The more people that we acquire through creators trusting us to put their content on, the more credit cards we get, and we have multiple million credit cards on file now through that process. And tens of thousands of people selling, I think 34,000, they said 27, now 34,000 titles on the service. But we've got to do better than that. We are in the process of looking at how we can create better funnels, a better viewing experience that is across all of the connected devices, right? Vimeo, again, is a really great B2B tool, but we have to be a better audience tool. And so when we relaunch our next version of Apple TV or we relaunch our next Android app, it's all going to be focused on that audience facing so that we can take the 190 million people that come to Vimeo on a monthly basis and say, you have to explore all of these amazing pieces of really unique independent content that we showcase, but we also need to use the data. Like, who are you? Where are you coming from? Which, again, is why it all comes down to that data.
Like, wouldn't the thing be for YouTube to buy Vimeo?
There would probably be an antitrust issue. I mean, I'm not an attorney, but...
An antitrust issue?
Yeah, well...
Really?
I think we're down to two major online video platforms, three if you count Dailymotion. If YouTube bought Vimeo, I think that the government would have probably an issue with that.
Wow, that's interesting.
And I think the creative community would cry foul. And I would have an issue with it. I would stand in the way, chain myself to the building.
But what I'm saying is, YouTube is so good at one set of things, the consumer-facing that you're talking about, and they've been struggling to achieve what you have already achieved, and you're working it the other way. So it just seems like
it's an interesting conundrum.
They have some cash.
Yeah, look, Google certainly does. Look, I think Vimeo's best path is if we remain independent, and we intend to remain independent of a major company like a Google or an Apple or whomever, because we really are passionate about representing independent voices, the people in this room, the people at this festival, the people who are making interesting content. If we lose that, if YouTube were to buy us or someone else, and we were just cats on pianos, it would destroy what is fundamentally the key value proposition of our platform. I like to say YouTube and Vimeo are like Walmart and Bloomingdale's. We both are video sharing platforms, but we're fundamentally... But we're fundamentally different. You go to Walmart, you buy something. You go to Bloomingdale's, you buy something. But you know when you go to Bloomingdale's that you're having a totally different experience than when you're at Walmart. And so we do need to get better, to your question, at making that. And that is probably the number one focus for the company going forward into 2016 is to do just that, next to our female filmmaker.
Sorry, what's your plan is to keep it strictly transactional, whereas Amazon has Prime, which I assure you the $10 million film is not going to be
free to the Prime member, sure. there will be, I imagine, a transactional fee. You're not going to have a...
I wouldn't have thought so. If you subscribe to Prime, you should probably get that
you
film.
You should get it for free.
Yeah, I think, I'm sure you will.
That would be ideal.
That's why they're buying this. They're trying to get people to subscribe to Prime.
So right now, the transactional model, the reason that we've gone with the transactional model is it's the most direct way for filmmakers to engage with their audience. If we did a subscription model, then it's the filmmakers and Vimeo and the audience, and that is a little bit more, it's a little more opaque. And so we really want to make sure that that transactional service and the free Vimeo are an amazing viewer destination, that filmmakers, to your point earlier, can make a living by making content and selling it on Vimeo. And if we get that to be the, we are the largest open selling platform on the globe for transactional video. And when I say open, I mean any filmmaker with a film that wants to sell it anywhere in the world can use Vimeo right now today and do that. But we can make that 10 times bigger and 10 times better. And, in the future, does that mean subscription? Who knows? But right now, transactional for us is the most direct way that we can put money into filmmakers' pockets.
Fantastic. Well, we're going to probably have to wrap it there, but we invite everyone to please stay and have a drink and continue the conversation one-on-one. But thank you so much. It's really, really talented.
Thank you.